Today, I'm going to discuss about generic attributes, which is introduced in C# 11 and .NET 7. Before we get into generic attributes, let me do a quick rundown of what an attribute is. An attribute is used to decorate other types to define metadata of that type. And attributes are mainly used through reflection for reading metadata and acting on it. An attribute is created by deriving any class from system.attribute base class. And a common example of attribute is during JSON serialization, where we can decorate a JSON property name different from the actual model property name. For example, here in this user class, I have created a JSON property attribute. I added it to the address and I changed the name of the address into ADDD. So when this user object is converted into JSON, or if a JSON is deserialized from a JSON string into this object, the address property in the JSON file will be ADD. Before C# 11, if we had to implement a generic attribute, we will use constructor of the attribute to pass the type, and let's see how we can do that. So for that, I'm going to go ahead and create a new class, and I'm going to name this class as custom attribute. And this class, as I mentioned, will derive from the attribute base class. Now, if we create a constructor of this class, the constructor of this class can take a type object, and then we can expose this type through a public property. Let's name it as current type, and it's going to return the type variable. So this is an example of an attribute where it is kind of behaving like a generic attribute, because we can provide the type in the constructor, and based on that, this attribute is going to act. Now, in this example, we are not doing anything with the type. We are just returning the type in the current type property, which can be used by the application which is using reflection on the type which will use this attribute. Now, for example, here for the user, now if we add this attribute to the user class, so we can add the custom attribute, and here we can pass type of string. Now at this point, this class is decorated with this custom attribute. And now in the program, what we can do is we can say var type is equal to type of user. And then we can use reflection here. So we can say var custom attributes is equal to type dot get custom attributes. And for the inherited Boolean parameter here, which says that if it is true, then it will search this member's inheritance chain, which we don't want. So we're just going to set it as false. So we got, and then what we can do is we can run a for each loop on the custom attributes. And what we can do is we can check if the custom attribute is indeed our custom attribute. So if we say, if custom attribute is custom attribute, and if that's the case, what we can do is we can do console dot write line, and here we can just print out the type property. So we can say custom attribute, we are type casting the custom attribute object here. And then here we can do dot current type, and it's going to print out the name of the current type. So now if I run this application, it is going to show string as the name of the type, because that is what we passed in the constructor of the attribute. So you can see it is string. So if we see here, this was the type, and this is the constructor where we passed a string. Now in C# 11, to do the same thing, instead of doing all this complexity, we can simply use a generic type. And then all we have to do is we can get rid of all of this. And then here, what we can do is we can just say for this particular generic type, type of T, that's all. It will return the type that is incoming. And here now, if we go to user, you can see it is now throwing an error, or the red squiggly is because it's generic. So we can just change it and make it as generic string type. And that's all is needed. And now in the program also, our casting is going to change. And let's typecast this. We know we are passing string, so we're going to check against string. And here also, we can typecast it as custom attribute of string. And now if we run this, we are going to see the exact same response as before, which is string, as expected. Now the question that you might have is, what is the advantage of this implementation of custom attribute over the previous implementation of passing the type itself in constructor? Well, the first advantage is the code is very small. And the second advantage is the generic attribute is much more strict and type safe and has better contract. Better contract in the sense, what we can do here is we can say where T is class. Once we do that, whoever is setting this value, they cannot set anything which is not a class. For example, after we set this as int, if we build this, we can see that it is throwing an error here. It says type, it must be a reference type in order to use it in the parameter T of generic type or method custom attribute of T. For some reason, the red squiggly is not showing up, but you can see the build is failed. So that's a very important advantage for using a generic attribute, because we can specify much more stricter rule on what can be a T, which is not possible if the type is passed as a constructor. It is not going to be compile time. We can add constraint, but all those checks will be runtime rather than compile time. So this is much better in that sense. Now, there are a couple of things we need to keep in mind in terms of the generic attribute. There are a couple of things that we cannot do with generic attribute. The first thing is, if we have a class which is generic, so for example, let's create a class here. And let's say generic user, which takes T. And let's say it has a property string. Now for this one, if we try to use the custom attribute, we cannot pass T here. That's not possible. We can pass string or anything else for that matter, but we cannot pass T. So that's first limitation. And the second limitation is there are few types that cannot be passed as a part of the generic attribute. The first one is dynamic. So dynamic cannot be passed as generic attribute. Now it is not showing red squiggly, but if I build this, you can see here, dynamic cannot be used in this context. Now let me change this to string so that we have only one error left. And you can see now, red squiggly decided to show up again, but you can see that type dynamic cannot be used in this context. The other thing that we cannot use is nullable types. So we can use string, but we cannot use a nullable string. And you can see it is throwing an error here that we cannot use nullable string. And the third thing is we cannot use a tuple here in this format. So again, the red squiggly is not showing up. So let me build this. And you can see it is showing this error. The type must be a reference. Okay, let me first remove the reference type reference from here so that we get only one error. And you can see we're getting error that type int of a comma int of b cannot be used in this context. Now we can still use tuple, but instead of using this syntax, we can always use tuple syntax. So we can always use this syntax in the custom attribute. And now if I build this, you can see that there is no error with that. It is successfully building. So this is all I wanted to cover as a part of generic attribute. If you like this video, please give me a thumbs up. If you are new to my channel and you think you are getting value out of my channel, please subscribe to my channel. And thanks so much for watching this video.